Assalamu alaikum, my dear student. I am Dr. Mahbub Alam, professor and head of the department of otolaryngology of the Ad-Din Medical College. Due to the coronavirus problem, may Allah save us from the coronavirus. Today my topic is lateral sinus thrombosis. And lateral sinus thrombosis is one of the complications of the chronic otitis media, which accounts for 30% of the intracranial complication in pre-antibiotic era. But now the sigmoid sinus thrombosis or lateral sinus thrombosis is very rare, but the extreme serious complication of the chronic otitis media is lateral sinus thrombosis, which needs the early recognition and treatment. And definition is it is the inflammation of the inner wall of the lateral venous sinus with formation of a thrombus. And what is lateral sinus? Lateral sinus is the sigmoid sinus and the transverse sinus together is called the lateral sinus. The route of infection of the lateral sinus is the infection spreads to the venous sinus directly from the mastoid or via any of the venous sinus channels draining the middle ear and mastoid. And what will be the organism of the lateral sinus thrombosis? First one is the beta hemolytic streptococcus is the common, then streptococcus pneumoniae, staphylococcus and proteus mirabilis, E. coli and the anaerobic bacteria. And there is a pathology of the lateral sinus thrombosis. The pathological process can be divided into the four stages. Number one, the formation of the pre-sinus abscess, endophlebitis and mural thrombus formation, obliteration of the sinus lumen and intersinus abscess, then extension of the thrombus. Now first one, the formation of the lateral pre-sinus abscess is abscess formed in relation to the outer dural wall of the sinus. And number two, the endophlebitis and mural thrombus formation, the inflammation spreads to the inner wall of the venous sinus with deposition of the fibrin, platelet and the blood cell leads to the thrombus formation within the lumen of the sinus. Then the obliteration of the sinus lumen and intersinus abscess, mural thrombus enlarges to occlude the sinus completely and organism may invade the thrombus causing intrasinus abscess. And then the fourth one is the extension of the thrombus. It can extend in both directions, proximally and distally. Proximally, it may spread to the confluence of the sinuses and superior sagittal sinus or cavernous sinus. And distally, it extends into the mastoid emissary vein to jugular valve or internal jugular vein. Then we have described the clinical feature. First of all, the hectic rise of temperature, which is associated with the chill and rigor, and which is called the spiking or picket fence pattern of the fever, and which is usually 103 degree Fahrenheit or more. And temperature and the character of the fever is the temperature comes down suddenly to normal with profuse sweating, but the pulse rate remains fast. Between the bouts of the fever, the patient looks surprisingly well and is free from the symptom. Though there is one thing is the rigors in the presence of the chronic otitis media always suggests the sigmoid sinus thrombosis or lateral sinus thrombosis. And the fever pattern, which is shown in this figure, that is this is the picket fence appearance. Have you seen the picket fence appearance? It is comes down to the baseline and it is going up, then again comes to the baseline. This is the picket fence appearance. Then the headache and malaise, which is often the only symptom when the pre-sinus abscess develops or the raised intracranial pressure developed. That is the headache and malaise. Number three, the features due to the extension of the thrombus. Number one, if the thrombus is spread to the jugular valve or internal jugular vein, then pain in the neck and tenderness along the internal jugular vein and clot may be felt as a tender cord in the neck and there is torticollis. And if the thrombus is spread to the superior sagittal sinus, then there will be the papilledema which is seen on the fundoscopy, then the visual loss and the otitic hydrocephalus. If it spreads to the cavernous sinus, then there will be the symptom of the proptosis, chemosis and the edema of the upper half of the face. If it spread to the mastoid emissary vein, then there will be pitting edema, erythema and the tenderness over the mastoid, which is called the Geisinger sign, which is positive when it is spread to the mastoid emissary vein. And if it is spread to the inferior petrosal sinus, then there will be vitiligo syndrome And Grady-Neagle syndrome is the consist of the three symptoms which can be mnemonized by 3D. Number one, the discharge. Number two is the diplopia. Number three, deep temporal headache. These three symptoms together is called Grady-Neagle syndrome. Diplopia usually due to the sixth cranial nerve palsy. Then there will be the progressive anemia due to the beta hemolytic streptococcus, which causes the RBC breakdown. And fifth one is the air discharge and the deafness. The seventh one is the Tobbe air test. Positive Tobbe air test is a compressing the jugular vein of the normal side will cause the rise in CSF pressure, but no or little rise when we press in the affected side. And last of all, the Crow-Beak test will be positive. The pressure on the internal jugular vein of the healthy side produce the engorgement of the retinal veins, which can be seen by ophthalmoscope. This is the ophthalmoscopic finding. And there is the investigation. There is investigation. The first of all, the CT scan, contrast CT scan, enhanced CT scan imaging may show a delta sign, central non-enhanced lumen surrounded by the enhancing dural sinus. You can see it by the CT scan. There is delta sign, and there is also the delta sign here. There is the enhancement of the dural sinus wall with the non-enhancement lumen the inside. Then is the MRI scan, MRI, and superior to the CT scan, as it can demonstrate the low or absent flow or clot formation and presence of the enhancing region. And third is the MRA, which is the confirmatory test. Magnetic resonance angiography is the confirmatory test. Then another one is the digital subtraction angiography, or DSA, is the another test. Then lumbar puncture, we are doing the positive Tobbe air test. And blood counts shows the polymorphic leukocytosis and the low hemoglobin concentration. And blood culture may show the causative organism if taken during the febrile phase. What will be the differential diagnosis? The differential diagnosis will be, number one, the malaria, typhoid fever, bronchopneumonia, and the pyelitis. Remember, the differential diagnosis will be malaria, typhoid fever, bronchopneumonia, and the pyelitis. Treatment consists of the administration of the intravenous high antibiotic together with the exposure of the lateral sinus and incision and removal of its contents. And exposure of the lateral sinus should be done by the radical mastectomy in case of chronic otitis media. If it is due to the acute otitis media and the coalescent mastoiditis, the cortical mastectomy is needed. But here the antibiotic will be the ampicillin, gentamicin, and the metronidazole is the combination drug, or the ceftriaxone or metronidazole, till the patient recover. And once the patient's general condition has been stabilized with antibiotic or deteriorates, then within first 2 days, surgical access to the lateral sinus is through the mastoid. Therefore, the air should be managed at the same time. And the surgical access to the air sinus, by it we are doing clearing of the disease from the mastoid by radical mastoidectomy, because it is due to the chronic otitis media. And bone covering the lateral sinus is removed, and the sinus is inspected, and the sinus is opened, and infected clot is removed. Bleeding is usually controlled by placing the packing between the walls of the sinus and the bone. Those who are going to get the honors mark in Viva, they can be asked, what will be the procedure? Once the sinus is exposed, diagnosis should be confirmed by inserting a needle through the wall into the lumen. If the sinus appears white, opaque, and firm in consistency, then the diagnosis is correct. Then the lateral sinus should be opened by longitudinal incision, and infected clot is removed until the free flow of the blood is achieved. And there is, if it is occasionally necessary to ligate the internal jugular vein, and anticoagulant therapy is not much favored nowadays because it has inherent danger. These are all about the lateral sinus thrombosis due to the complication of the chronic otitis media. Assalamu alaikum.